Joel Singer, Joel Silver will reconvene us after the break, and Joel is the director of the Lilly Library at Indiana University. So we have a very strong connection now, because some of you may know that Brenda Johnson, the dean of libraries at Indiana, has just been appointed the new university librarian at Chicago. So I'm going to thank Joel in advance for sending us someone who is well-schooled in the value of special collections.
Welcome back for the first of this colloquium's panel discussions. And the title of our panel is Acknowledging the Past. And we've been doing a little bit of that already, and I'm sure we'll continue to do that for the rest of the day and tomorrow. But this panel is specifically devoted to looking at the past and what has endured and what has not. Nearly 50 years ago, Gordon Ray, a collector and very eminent bibliophile whose collection went to the Morgan Library, wrote an important article publishing the results of a survey that he did entitled The Changing World of Rare Books. And he had surveyed a number of collectors, booksellers, and librarians, and Ray saw the world of rare books as consisting of those three groups. And he, through their responses and through his own experience, he chronicled the symbiotic but competitive relationship between those groups. And there's a lot that can be learned from Ray's article, and also from looking at what booksellers, collectors, and librarians do and have done. And all of these groups are represented on our panel. We have a collector, Paul Ruxin, who is a well-known collector of Samuel Johnson and James Boswell. Ken Lopez, a bookseller of many decades experience with a specialty in modern literature. And Daniel D. Simone, Eric Weinmann, librarian at the Folger Shakespeare Library. And before that, curator of the Lessing J. Rosenwald collection at the Library of Congress. And before that, an antiquarian bookseller, so it represents both worlds. And Elizabeth Haven Hawley, who is chair of the Special and Area Studies Department at the George A. Smathers Libraries at the University of Florida, who has a doctorate in the sociology and history of technology and has studied in depth the history of printing, the practices of printing, and the sociological implications of print and access to print. And we'll hear from all of these panelists, and then we'll open up the floor for what I hope will be your questions and comments. And we'll start with Paul.
Some of what I'm going to say has been touched on by earlier speakers, but we were told to talk about the past and acknowledge the past, and so I thought I would begin with three dates. The first one you've already heard alluded to, April 4th, 2001, when the collectors and special collections talks were given at the Library of Congress. Bob Jackson summarized his own remarks there, but I want to say that looking at special collections now and for the future, you can hardly do better than go back to those three talks. They're published in this format. I brought a copy with me so you can see pictures of what Alice and Bob Jackson and Dan and Mark Dimunation looked like in April of 2001. This version of their talks is a little hard to find. It may be easier to find Elective Affinities, which is Alice's talk. It's a profound talk. It deals with very important issues, and issues I think are not going to be touched on much in this session. Most special collections, or at least much of many special collections, were collected by collectors. They were not built from scratch by special collections librarians. And these days, there are fewer collectors of serious books, and there are fewer older, important books to collect than there were. And so the future of special collections may not be so much adding to special collections as it may be making special collections available to a much wider audience than they ever have been before, and that's been touched on. I encourage you to find at least find Alice's talk and read it. The second date I want to touch on is much more recent and astonishing. The date is August 25th, 2014, not long ago. A few days before that, in Tampa, Florida, a new college, university opened, Florida Polytechnic University. And it opened to great fanfare in part because Santiago Calatrava, the great Spanish architect, designed it. What's important for our purposes, though, is that, as the university's director of library said, there are no books in the library. It's a boldly relevant decision to go forward without books, said Catherine Miller. It's an all-digital library. There are no books there. A spokesman for the American Library Association put it this way. Digital is in some ways better. People can find things easier. Now, one listens to that and wishes that at least they had a copy of Strunk and White. But I suppose even Strunk and White is online if you care to look. Is it possible, is it important that there is now a new university proud of the fact that its library has no books? I think it is important, and that will bring me to my third date, which will be an illustration, if a small one, of why I think special collections are not only important, but will endure. And as Bob Jackson told us, part of what we're here today and tomorrow to discuss is shaping the future for special collections libraries. And so the date I want to refer to now is February 25th, 1987. And on that date, someone whose name has already been mentioned here today, David Vandermeulen, gave the Engelhardt Lecture at the Library of Congress. And the lecture he gave was called Where Angels Fear to Tread, Descriptive Bibliography and Alexander Pope. There are many reasons why special collections libraries will be important. Two obvious ones, for instance, are despite digitization, digitization is and will be for a long time imperfect. Anyone who's tried to read something on Ebo or Echo or the HathiTrust or Google Books has often found it simply illegible, or parts of it are illegible, or parts of it are missing. It's also expensive. If your institution does not have a subscription to Ebo or Echo, and many institutions cannot afford the outrageous fees that are charged, you, as a scholar, will not have access to those digital images. So, special collections and physical books will remain important because digital images, even as they improve, will not be universally available for a very long time. That's one reason. Another reason is to look at things that you need to see. It's the emotional result of looking at the physical object that Alice talked about that all of us have experienced. It's looking at the annotations. It's looking at the thoughts that someone carefully penciled in the margins 100 or 200 or 400 years ago. That's important too. But I want to focus on something else, something that I think has been overlooked, underutilized, something that has fallen into somewhat of a decline. And I think David Vandermeulen's talk is the best way to get at it. And that is descriptive bibliography. Descriptive bibliography has been around for a long time, no doubt about it. Even if we only begin with the seminal work of Fredson Bowers and the update by Philip Gaskell, it's something that has been around for a while that used to be widely, much more widely studied and understood. There was a time, I believe, when most PhDs, in English at least, had more than passing familiarity with formal descriptive bibliography. I myself do not think it's possible to consider yourself a serious collector or a serious special collections librarian without understanding descriptive bibliography, formal descriptive bibliography. Why is that? Well, the obvious reason is there are things that you have to have the physical object to understand. David Vandermeulen's talk at the Library of Congress was about his then work in progress, his bibliography of Pope and especially the Dunciad. I don't know if many of you have read this work. If you haven't, I commend it to you. But David talked about his process, what he went through. At the time, he was not finished, but at the time, he had reviewed 800 copies of 33 editions of the Dunciad. Why is that important? And why cannot digital images ever supplant that effort? Let me just read you briefly part of his description of part of what he did. He had a micrometer with him at the British Library, where he was examining the British Library's collection of the Dunciad, which is, I think, the single largest collection extant. He said this, "With the micrometer, I measured paper thickness. First, the total bulk of all the leaves that had passed through the press. And then I measured the thickness of each leaf at the center of its three outside edges." Now, an earlier bibliography of Pope Griffith, according to David, did this. He distinguished issues of Pope's work as being on second royal paper, on still thicker royal paper, and on very thick royal paper. Obviously, enormously imprecise way of comparing copies of the Dunciad. He had to have a micrometer and physically measure the pages. Digitization, Alice suggested, may someday allow us to smell things. Maybe. I think we're a long way from when digitization will allow scholars and librarians to physically handle, measure, touch, feel the physical objects that we care so much about. So it seems to me that special collections ought to shape their own future by re-emphasizing descriptive bibliography, by introducing its students and its librarians to the concepts of descriptive bibliography, by telling them how the results of that scholarship, that kind of scholarship, take the book as object and the book as text, the book as information and the book as things, and put them together. That, to me, is the role for the future of special libraries, to deliver that message. Why is that important? I think the answer, again, is probably best stated by David Vandermeulen, who, at the end of his lecture, said this, "It is a process that brings us not only closer to the minds and actions of those who manufactured the books, but also, ultimately, into the presence of Alexander Pope himself." That is the mission of special collections. Thank you.
Kim?
My name's Ken Lopez. I'm a bookseller. I've been a bookseller for about 40 years, and I deal primarily in modern literary first editions, which led me to dealing with living writers' literary archives, which I've been doing now since about 1990. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how the archives that I've been handling over in recent years have changed. Digitization is a big part of this, obviously. There are some other factors as well. And so looking at the past and acknowledging the past is a big part of what literary archives and preserving them is about. And I'm going to offer a few comments on the changes that I've seen and what we're experiencing right now. One of the first things that's obvious is that the archives that I'm handling these days, we very seldom anymore see the kind of cut and paste manuscripts that used to be prevalent in a writer's archive, where they would write a draft, then revise it by cutting and pasting the revisions onto the original sheets of paper because they didn't want to have to retype the entire thing. And in those cases, the manuscript showed the physical evidence of the author reworking it, trying to improve it, trying to get it right. You could see the archaeology of the work by looking at a single draft with its corrections. These days, what you tend to get, and in those archives, you'd get one or two heavily annotated drafts that, you know, yielded a lot of information about the process of writing the work. These days, you don't see that very much. What you do see is a lot of paper. It's very easy to press the print key and get a whole new, clean typescript. And you'll get a single book, will be a half a dozen, sometimes three boxes of manuscripts, all with very slight changes, but all very, very difficult to, unless you also have the digital versions of them, very difficult to collate and understand the process of the work. So one of the things that has changed a lot is that sense that viewing the evolution of a writer's work is kind of self-evident, obvious, and easy in a literary archive. It these days, especially with more digitization, it can be hard to do that unless the digital files are retained. There are other things that used to appear regularly in archives that occurred to me as I was thinking about, you know, what has changed in the archives I'm dealing with. And one of them was seemingly pretty slight or trivial, are things like brochures. And it occurred to me that until I arrived here today and got my program for this event, I had not seen anything on paper about this event. It was all via email and via the website and so forth, which is really great in the sense that trees weren't sacrificed for this. But I was dealing with a writer's archive a couple of years ago, and it was a large archive. A couple of librarians were coming to look at it, and we realized belatedly that we had forgotten about the boxes in the garage. We had all these hundreds of boxes, literally, that we had prepared to show the librarians and so forth. It was almost overwhelming. But then there were all these others in the garage, and we thought, oh my God, this is going to overwhelm them. It's all full of junk. You know, we've got to go out there and clean them up and, you know, get the good stuff, save the good stuff, and get rid of the trash. So she and I went out to the garage and started pulling out all the kind of marketing materials for writers' workshops and things like that that she had received over the past however many years, and we're throwing them away so that what's left is a high percentage of kind of original, unique material. We thought we were doing a very good thing for the librarians who were coming, and when they arrived, we told them what we had done, and they were aghast. They looked at us and they understood, you know, that the unique materials, yes, they have some value and so forth, but what we weren't thinking of was that these brochures about these events, these marketing materials, 100 years from now, they might be the only information, the only evidence that such events had ever taken place. And to have lost them would have been a significant loss. In a certain sense, I tend to view archives as mosaics, and the pieces of the archive are a single piece in a mosaic that is trying to create a picture that is understandable and convey some meaning and information. And they're never complete, but they create a picture that can't be assembled otherwise. So it's important they're preserved in order to recognize and in some ways reconstruct something of value from the past. So even something as mundane and seemingly trivial as brochures and marketing materials, you know, their existence matters in terms of our understanding and knowledge of the time and milieu in which they were created. Correspondence is kind of another obvious one that has changed since I first started dealing in archives. And, you know, everyone knows that archives used to contain lots of letters, and the and in time, nowadays the letters that tend to be in an archive or tend to be form letters, they tend to be or formal letters. The personal communications are more likely to take the form these days of emails, telephone calls, social media postings, and so forth. And I was recently working on an archive that had a group of letters from a writer to his wife while he was at a months-long writing workshop in the early 1960s. And he told her about the informal Thursday night readings that the writers in the workshop were holding for each other. And it turned out that these Thursday night readings became kind of Thursday night parties, and they would drink alcohol and so forth, and then somebody brought marijuana and they turned into Thursday night pot parties. And before too long, somebody found out about LSD and they turned into Thursday night LSD parties. And this is when LSD was still legal. And the writer hosting these parties was Ken Kesey. He was at the Stanford writing program at the time. And after he graduated from the writing program, he took the concept that these readings had developed into and called them the acid tests, and created a series of these events around the San Francisco Bay Area. And those acid tests became these kind of public gatherings for what came to be the 1960s counterculture. They evolved into, really, the communal events of the counterculture were these large free rock concerts where LSD was distributed freely and so forth. By then it was illegal too. And you know, they had those in Golden Gate Park. The most famous one is Woodstock. And so in this writer's letters was the beginning of the process of getting to Woodstock. And I would never have known, no one would have known, that Woodstock grew out of literary writers' informal readings on Thursday night in the Stanford writing program, but it did. So these days, that kind of communication would be done, you know, and even as early as the 1970s when long-distance telephone got cheaper, those kinds of letters really didn't happen much anymore, and that communication would be lost, and part of that lineage of an event like Woodstock would have disappeared from the mosaic. It would be much harder to fill in. So that's the kind of thing that this correspondence in an archive preserves, or at least acknowledges the past in an important way. Another thing that the archives tend to have, almost every archive I've had has had a random or miscellaneous group of photographs, sometimes a handful, sometimes hundreds, sometimes thousands. A recent archive I sold was about two-thirds digital, and the photos were harder to find because they weren't just lying around in boxes. They had resided on different machines over the years. They had been preserved in different ways by the writer, and it occurred to me to wonder, you know, if this writer had died. And these days, a lot of storage is moving from one's own personal computer, which has been superseded in many cases by one's iPad or smartphone or something like that. And so the excess storage is being stored in the cloud. If this writer had died, we would be wondering, did he have cloud storage somewhere? Are there thousands of photographs that are not only have no physical presence, but can't be located digitally here in this house? You would have to know the existence of an account, you would have to know the writer's password, you have to know that these things existed in order to find them. So these things stand a risk of getting lost at this point in a way that they didn't when they had this physical manifestation. One of my customers, a collector, was a John Updike scholar, or is actually still. And he ran a John Updike website for many years, and it was full of bibliographic information and photos and gossip, and, you know, he had a forum where other people, interested people, could communicate with each other and ask and answer questions and comment and so forth. And One day his ISP simply shut down. It was a small business up in Maine, and they were apparently squeezed to the point where they couldn't make a profit. And the owners simply unplugged the machines. And he called them up and said, well, can I at least get my stuff back? And they essentially said, no, we don't have time for you. And he lost 10 years worth of work that he had put in and others had put in about John Updike. It just disappeared overnight. It was in cyberspace one day, and it was out of existence the next. So there's a certain danger to the environment that we live in, where we're relying so entirely on non-physical materials. There was another recent archive I've been dealing with that has a large digital component. The writer had an assistant packing up the physical portions of it. And so he called me up and he said, he asked me, do you think they really want my honorary degrees? Do you think anybody's gonna actually look at them? Do you think maybe I should just send a scan of them? And I said, no, I think they do want them. I told him the whole point of these archives was to preserve the original items and the thing itself, not some representation of it. And this, I was reading a magazine the other day, and the rock and roll musician Neil Young, it was being written about it. He was using crowdsourcing to fund development of a digital music player that doesn't cut off all the high frequencies and the low frequencies the way iPods and smartphones and MP3 players do. And he compared listening to that kind of music to looking at a picture of the Mona Lisa as opposed to looking at the Mona Lisa herself. And so I was thinking, this is the same kind of thing that I told this writer, you're getting paid a lot of money for this archive. They want the archive. They don't want pictures of the archive. And so he began to understand and get it. But what that did for me was a little surprising. It made me realize or ask the question, well, you know, what is the thing itself that is being preserved here? Because I realized when I was talking to him that an image of an honorary degree is definitely not an honorary degree. But the honorary degree itself was not the thing itself. It was a representation of an honor that this institution was according to the writer. And in some sense, it was as much a pale shadow of the thing itself as the picture of the degree was, of the degree. And so what I started to think about was that the thing itself was an honor. It was an acknowledgement of the writer's work, and it was an indication of respect for it. But these things, these honor and respect, are intangibles. You can't frame them. You can't put them in a box and store them. They're part of what the poet Charles Olson called the human universe. They're, and similarly, a printed book or the manuscript of a book is not ultimately the thing itself, but it's something that points to the thing itself. A book matters, and its manuscript may be preserved and valued because of the ideas it contains, the perceptions it reveals, the insight it yields, the wisdom it shows, and its impact on us is in the way it enlightens us, broadens our understanding, widens our gaze, elevates us as thinking, feeling, living creatures. All of these things, wisdom, insight, understanding, perspective, are intangibles, but they are the thing itself, the things themselves. They're what make up what Olson called the human universe, what the theologian Teilhard de Chardin called the noosphere, which was the mental, emotional, and spiritual correlate to the physical atmosphere that surrounds us at all times, which we live in and breathe, and which our own thoughts and actions contribute to. These intangibles are what define us as human beings, and they are what will endure. If we think of ourselves as preserving, or in my case, as selling paper products, our jobs will end in the near future, or at least be reduced to triviality or irrelevancy. But if we think of ourselves as being involved in recognizing and preserving that which elevates us as humans, that which improves ourselves, our culture, humanity in general, or the earth at large, that task will continue and will take on new forms. These kinds of archives, one way or another, deserve our recognition, preserve our recognition of those things, those aspects of our humanity that exalt us and the world and the universe we live in. And it's an honor and a privilege to be a part of that process of helping preserve the thing itself, that which ultimately has value and meaning. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'm Dan DeSimone, librarian at the Folger Shakespeare Library. I appreciate being able to speak to all of you today. I was involved with the original program that Bob mentioned earlier and that Paul mentioned, and to be able to address this crowd today is quite an honor. I appreciate it. As I was thinking about what to talk about, there was questions that appeared in the program about what has endured, what has changed most, and what may not endure much longer about special collections. And I thought, well, maybe I could handle a couple of these issues. I'm not so sure I want to talk about what may not endure. But for the library world, I think that one of the great changes that has taken place out of the many, many changes that you'll hear about today is really the impact on research as a result of the digital text. And that within the institution, the library institution, the doors have been sort of blown open. And we have no more walls. But the library's position in this universe has also changed. It's not so much at the center of a space as many university libraries are, but it can actually be a remote space. And so that, I think, is one of the major changes that I perceive. Now being a librarian of an institution, I'm beginning to see what the impact is on how the operations of our library are being directed with this idea in mind. I think for the bookseller, of all the changes that you may hear about today and that you've experienced yourselves, I think it's the value of inventories that have changed over time, that with this middle layer, I think Bob mentioned it today, that the middle layer of the trade is vanishing. And what years ago would be a valuable book, maybe a couple $100 up to $1,000 book, now you go online and you find a dozen copies. And so that middle, and it's, as a result, it's extremely hard to sell. And so that I think the trade has had these 10 years or more trying to adjust how do we go about staying in business and fulfilling the needs of our clients if this sort of middle level is missing. And I think it's driven the bookseller to find, to collect, and to offer for sale more unique items, more manuscript materials, more annotated books, and ephemera. And I think the library world, obviously, we're in sync there, because I think most libraries are no longer just looking for text. We have access to text. Libraries are looking for these unique items or these annotated items, which will be useful for scholars to understand better about what readers were about, as opposed to maybe what the content of the book was about. And I think the private collector world, I've never been a private collector. I buy reference books. I am having a harder time understanding the transitions and the changes that are taking place. But if I may say a few observations, I think that from my observation, the collecting community is getting older. I think that they're looking to fill in as opposed to build. And I think that this is having a larger impact not only on the trade, but on some of the activities in which they're able to participate within the rare book community. So in observing these transitions in the rare book world for a couple decades anyhow, perhaps the most constant thread that I see within these three groups is the bond that's created between the bookseller, or among the bookseller, the librarian, and the private collector. And I think this venue here today with so many people and so many familiar faces is a testimony to this bond that that is created because of our relationship to the book. I'm going to crib from the International League of Antiquarian Booksellers when I say that the love of books unites us. And so that what we have is we have this commonality, and I think this is what allows us to be able to communicate in such a way that draws us together when we have these opportunities as has been offered us today. And I think that the, and I've learned that amongst these relationships, what's most enduring is the is what gives me the optimism for the future. Because I think it's this interaction that we have today which is going to sustain the book world no matter what changes we go through. And I think Ken was alluding to the human nature of what can be expressed in an archive. And I think that a program like this suggests the human relationships which are common to us all as either book collector or librarian or bookseller or a member of the general public who is curious about what we do. I think also this relationship will sustain us in the future because I think we're all looking for a new audience. And I know that the idea of the audience that we experience today, the audience at a book fair, is something that we understand. But I know at the institution for where I work, we're looking for new audiences. And we're looking for audiences that will come in, maybe see an exhibition, take advantage of the opportunity to see, in my case, a first folio, or the exhibition that we have on. But it may be just one time that we have access to this individual. And so I was thinking about, okay, what do we do if we say that we're looking for a new audience? How do we capture this audience so that with this one-time opportunity, we're able to have an impact on what they experience? So I was thinking that from the librarian point of view, especially because we have this group of librarians who are here, to be able to create a dialogue amongst ourselves about the audience and about how do we create almost a new form of language that we can come to agree on that may be useful across many of our programs to try and understand what to say through our docents or through our curators to people that come into an institution looking at books for the first time so that we may capture them in some way and have an impact on what they see. I think for the booksellers looking for a new audience, there's many times a refrain that I hear from booksellers is that they're really concerned about the new group of librarians that are coming onto the market. They don't have necessarily strong bibliographical skills. They understand special collections, but maybe not rare books. And I think for that audience, I think that booksellers have an opportunity to invite MLS students, first-year MLS students, to have internships in their businesses so that they can understand how a bookseller works, how the trade works, to have an internship not so that someone learns how to pack books, but it's like a personal assistant. So that they're able to really see what the bookseller goes through as he tries to run his business and tries to meet his clients, meet the needs of his clients. And I think that in 2015, if 10 booksellers were to have an intern, in 5 years, if they were to do this over time, you'd have 50 people who had gone through a process like this and really could have an impact over time on the relationship between the booksellers and creating this new audience for the book trade. And as was described by Alice so clearly about Mike Lang's collection, the way institutions deal with collectors and deal with collections is extremely important to generating a new audience. I just came here, before coming here, I was at the University of Dayton, where a private collector has put his exhibition, or put his books on exhibition. And the exhibition was really, he opened the doors to his collection. The faculty came in and they cherry-picked from his collection and they put together an exhibition. Now, many of the titles that they chose were not titles I would have chosen. They weren't the most important titles in the collection, but they were titles which were relevant to the institution and to the department and to the faculty member who made the choice. And then they wrote up descriptions, and then they got all the students in the humanities departments are now writing papers on individual books from this collection. So they're seeing the object. They're having an advantage of thinking about it. They're learning about these rare books. And so that these are just opportunities, I think, that we have to, if we wanted to really expand our audience, I think we have to communally think about it and maybe take advantage of opportunities to be able to articulate clearly some general, I don't want to say principles necessarily, but general ideas that may be useful for the rare book community, whether it be bookseller, collector, or librarian, to build a new audience for the future. Thank you.
For something completely different. I suppose that's partly because I'm the only woman up here. But regardless, I thank you very much, Joel, for that introduction, because it turns out I do have a very strong sociological component, and that's what kind of makes us a little bit different. So I hope that we all weave together somehow. I have worked closely with communities in the preservation of cultural heritage at a number of institutions, and one fact that's become apparent to me is that a community attaches to objects and uses to hold itself together certain meanings that are completely contrary to special collections professionals and our practices. We might say similar words, but our relationships to collections and to the objects themselves is fundamentally different. I think that the stories that communities tell about themselves may be told explicitly by text sometimes, but just as often the items that a community considers vital to its history are objects of social practice, and they do not fit into what we have the most skill at preserving. What are we going to do with ceremonial swords and flags of an ethnic fraternity? From thousands of objects, how do we choose the very few that can be sustained by our organization when the enormity of the collection is what expresses the community's identity? In short, how do we maintain authenticity in our operations, especially when objects mean different things as they move from creator users to special collections? We need to honor those who have long supported us, even as we make the powerful statement to those who have been locked out of public view and out of our very special collections that they do belong within our doors. So I offer a few ruminations on this topic, 8 to be precise. It's my favorite number. Concluding with a brief comment on a social theory concept called structuration by Anthony Giddens. Some of you may be aware of it. I think these can help us to think through what objects mean in special collections. And I want to avoid using air quotes, but sometimes they're appropriate, so forgive me if I say mean so that you understand I'm not meaning that word that I'm saying. I'm meaning something else. So 1, the artifact matters, but not in the way that we often think it does. I'm going to admit, when you hand me your business card, I'm polite and I say your name and I go, but I'm really thinking about everyone whose hands have touched that business card and how it came to you to give to me. I'm thinking about the writers and the designers, yes, but more particularly, because I've worked in printing, I think about all of the printers. I think about the person who cut out the cards. I think about the person who stripped it up so they could make the plate and then print it. Nowadays, it's more likely that the person who handed it to you got it off of an in-office printer that was already stacked up for them, and they put a nice little rubber band around it and handed it to you. But still, it's people. I think of these processes because I've done most of them myself. And it's much easier to be aware of each step in the hands that have made a thing possible when you see yourself somehow in that document. And this has little to do with the text. The processes of finding meaning in an artifact, of discerning the social configurations and agreements that are now part, that are part of how we relate to artifacts, exist alongside our mastery of intellectual content. It's fair to say that both of these are more important than the object itself, which cannot speak. And these words might not be quite what you expect to hear from someone who does forensic analysis of print and papermaking, and who has worked in the printing industry and been laid off and had enough scars from that direction. So, two, objects are meaningful when they are attached to stories, and it is an act of power to tell one's own story. Printers and book people have an advantage. We've had a pretty good command over our own story. We tell the stories and shape the stories that people tell about us. I think especially about the romantic visions of printing shops and how we've glorified our work and talked about artistry and emphasized the independent printer. But in reality, printing is a dirty, nasty occupation. In the hand press era, you could tell who the printers were as they walked down the street by the way they lurched. They were misshapen and malformed because of the way that they pulled on the press and by the very work that they did. We rarely think of those misshapen printers when we make printer's hats or purchase a rare broadside, but that is whose history we're actually collecting. We have instead created stories of the meaning of objects more from the context in which their continuity has been assured. We collect broadsides or the books of printers who are noted for success when we do choose to focus on the object itself. When we focus on literature, it's more often the kind that reflects a highly selective view of the past, a retrospective selection that emphasizes meaning to us more than the past as it was. Our selection positions us in the social structure, and inevitably, we're not at the bottom part of the social structure, as I have told my students. Three, we know that materiality is tied to meaning. But it's difficult to suss out just how that happens. One of my favorite things to do in teaching is to give students a book that's older than their great-great-grandparents and see what they do with it. I have yet to meet a student who didn't come away with a sense of awe. They're stunned at how long that book has existed. They feel a connection with the past through this artifact, though the object cannot speak its own words. But it has in its text images and signs of wear, something that represents continuity over time. The book's date and textual content may echo what that student has heard about past events. And all this makes me think that the past is, yes, a strange place, but one that has outlines that are somehow familiar. These books are ghosts on a cultural landscape. Material, but meaningful because they're embodiments of the larger social realities that frame a student's world. In a sense, we collect not books, but the ghosts who have made these objects and the outlines of the landscapes in which they lived. A student applies pre-existing knowledge to the artifact, trying to place it in a cultural order, and the textual content is only part of that experience. The student thinks, this thing has lasted. It was important to someone. It was important enough that someone saved it. And it was saved by everyone between them and me, between then and now. I have a connection to the person who first touched this thing. Four, it's true. Every generation between then and now has to say yes to keep a book alive. There is a concept I like very much in Judaism, and other cultures share it. It goes something like this. A person may not believe or follow the traditions, but you don't have a right to shut the door to those things for the next generation. Each generation must have its own opportunity to embrace the past and to carry it forward to the future. And we have a responsibility to keep doors open even when we choose to not walk through them. For me, this is what special collections are about: recognizing, sharing, and carrying forward cultural heritage. 5. Books are meaningful when attached to stories. Perhaps those stories are about the production or about a collector in whose hands a rare book has survived. Books are loaded with the freight of stories of entire communities as well. And we have some difficulty when a book or a set of books carries more weight than the paper or words that it holds. For each person and setting in which these books have survived before they find their way into special collections, they have served as memory markers and makers. Because objects have meaning due to their continuity, and that continuity is a social decision and relates to power and access to resources over time. With 6, books as objects and texts are conduits of information, and interaction with them is the source of memory. The brain creates memories through our repeated retrieval of facts and structuring of them into narratives. Objects have meaning when they're used, not merely because of the continuity of their existence. And it could be argued that without use and the continual construction, sharing, and repeating of memories as stories, objects themselves have no meaning. So, they require interaction, and their physicality, their smell, their textures, the sounds, they all evoke past experience and collapse time. 7. If objects help us to tell stories, we must pay attention to those whose objects are not in collections and to those whose stories are kept alive by artifacts without texts. Special collections have a great deal of experience acquiring materials that have already been separated in time from their origins. We're very strong in our connections to traditional collectors who have done the hard work of assembling coherent collections from the nooks and crannies of auctions, dealer catalogs, out-of-the-way bookstores, and sometimes serendipitous occasions. But the direct transfer of historical materials from creators can be challenging. An artist may refuse to have images released individually, asserting that only the oeuvre is the place to have authentic analysis of his work. True case. An ethnic leader providing documents may stipulate that they cannot be translated into another language without her permission, because only the mother tongue can convey concepts correctly. We come to 8. Here, it's useful to consider Anthony Giddens' theory of how we become ourselves in society. Giddens writes of structuration as an active working out of a balance between the social structure in which we operate and our ability or willingness to act apart from conventions. This interplay of structure and human agency, which we do every day of our lives, explains how we become who we are. We are neither determined by society, nor are we completely independent. One might create a theory of the structuration of artifacts. I'm not sure that one exists, but let's make it. We can apply structuration as the generation of meaning from historical materials through the balancing of known meanings, and particularly of those who created an object, and the discovery, or perhaps the uncovering, of new meanings, quite apart from those of the past. How do we balance the meaning of a book given to it by its creator with how patrons relate to it over time in special collections? Considering the structuration of artifacts helps us to explore our own positions in the social structure as donors, as librarians, as researchers, and to shape that process. And so we might ask, whose hands touched this book before it came into our possession? And how? What experiences have been enabled and what meanings facilitated by its materiality over time with continuity? What does inclusion in special collections, and particularly the transfer of materials to institutions with no direct connection to creators, mean? We need to consider these things in order to negotiate the objectness or objectivity of an artifact. We are one generation, one of many which will be necessary to carry such things forward. Considering these aspects of our work helps us to keep a door open from the past to the present and the future. Thank you.
So do we have questions or comments? There were a number of things raised during the panel.
Hi, Melissa Hubbard. I work here in Kelvin Smith Library. I want to thank you all first for four wonderful talks. Thank you all so much. And yes, yay. I actually wanted to ask about descriptive bibliography. I learned descriptive bibliography as a student from Charles McNamara at University of North Carolina. I loved it. Loved it. And when I got my first job as a rare book librarian, I was really excited about, you know, all the bibliography I was going to be doing. And I have not found many occasions to use those skills, to be honest. They have been used, certainly, in the course of my professional work. But it's not one of my more useful skills. And that depresses me, honestly, because I wish I, you know, could do more of it. And so I'm interested. I think you're a really great group of people to talk about this a little bit. Descriptive bibliography is very much about material. It is a little bit more difficult to connect it to meaning. And I wonder if any of you have any thoughts about that.
I might have started this conversation. It's embarrassing to talk about descriptive bibliography with Terry Bellinger sitting there, thinking every word I say is probably
wrong. Let's do
wrong,
it anyway.
But let me say, as a collector, there were two moments when I understood I was a collector. The first was when the phone rang. I'd been buying Johnson & Boswell for a couple of years. The phone rang. It was a dealer who said, "I understand you're a collector," something that had never crossed my mind. But I knew from that moment on that I probably was. But the second and the more important moment was when I realized that I didn't really understand enough about what was being offered to me, about what I saw, that I couldn't necessarily rely on dealers' catalogs, dealers' descriptions, that I needed to really see the book and follow through on the rules of descriptive bibliography. The best example I can give to you of why this is important to collectors, or should be, a few years ago, I went to a book fair, and I was talking to Rob Rulon Miller, some of you know Rob, about Johnson, and the dealer in the next booth overheard us, and he said, "Oh, I have a Johnson dictionary. Are you interested?" And I said, "Of course, let me see it." And he showed me a book that said it was printed in 1787, and it was the 8th edition of Johnson's dictionary. Well, I know what the 8th edition of Johnson's dictionary is, and that wasn't it, at least it wasn't that title page. What I did was I took the book and I went home and I took Fleeman's bibliography. And because I understood the basic principles of descriptive bibliography, I was able to determine from Fleeman's descriptions of the 8th and other editions exactly what that was. It turns out it was a very rare Dublin piracy, and only one other copy was known to exist. This copy wasn't known. There was one copy known to exist. So I went back to the book fair, and I said to the dealer, "Sorry, I have some bad news for you. It's not what you think it is. It's not the 8th edition. It's a piracy." And he was crestfallen. He said, "Oh, well, would you take it anyway for half the price?" So, is descriptive bibliography useful? I guess it is. I guess so.
Well, I'll speak up. I've had the good fortune of having served as a lab instructor for descriptive bibliography at Rare Book School, first under Terry Bellinger and now under Michael Suarez. And the research that I've done into marginalized communities and the publications that were produced by gray literature, marginal publishers, simply would not be possible without looking at them as an artifact. So, yeah, my dissertation would be about that.
I think you bring up an interesting point about the difference between a special collections librarian and a curator. And I think that the institutions that have the ability to have curators who are dedicated to collections have a greater opportunity to use the skills that you learned mm-hmm. in graduate school and from the rare book school. That's a privilege, actually, to be a curator, I think, and because it allows you that the time. I mean, it's your responsibility, actually, it's your job description to be able to delve into the history of objects and the history of the bibliographical history of a book. And I think that it not being able to do that because you have administrative responsibilities or you're running an exhibition or you're putting on a program like this, it makes it for a very difficult difficult transition. And I think it's one of the things that worries booksellers a little bit is that, because the libraries are so lean that everybody's their own administrator. And so we've got, you're just working in a different capacity than maybe you were trained for.
I also wanted to mention something that Alice said earlier in her response to Terry's question when Alice was talking about the rise in outreach librarians and outreach activities among special collections libraries. And this is an area that certainly has grown over the last several decades. And so special collections librarians now are doing a great deal more of teaching in a wide sense to a wide variety of people. And one of the things that they are teaching and can teach is that just because two copies of a book look the same, it doesn't mean that they are the same. And that can begin to lead to an interest in descriptive bibliography. But it's going to take a while. I mean, as many of you know, 40 years ago, 50 years ago, every graduate student in English would have learned some descriptive bibliography as part of a methods class, and now that's been replaced with theory in most cases. And so it's going to take some time, but I think the idea that special collections libraries are open and open to a wider variety of people than they were before gives us the opportunity to teach things that we didn't and couldn't before.
And I just wanted to follow up just a bit. One of the things that we're really missing is a commitment to collaborative descriptive bibliography. The threshold is very high if you do an intensive bibliography. You have to be from a major institution and have phenomenal institutional resources available to you. It has to be your job. There is no casual, meaningful descriptive bibliography. And you ruin books while you're doing it. So you have to be good at it. But we could learn so much more about the regional bookselling trade, about printing, about readership all through the United States or in other countries if we had collaborative descriptive bibliography through databases that are similar to medical databases. We could be looking at very physical details, but it all requires conventions and agreements about exactly how you're going to digitize something. You have to use raked light here. You have to do this kind of RGB. I'm getting in over my head now. But these are things that we should be doing, and I would be very interested in hearing other people who have some ideas of leadership in that area.
Thank you.
Yes, I have a question.
Yeah, my name is this on? Yeah, Malcolm O'Hagan. I'm with the American Writers Museum, and I'm all about presentation and outreach, and this panel was very stimulating. I'm associated with the Library of Congress as well, but in a very small way. It's my volunteer activity. I'm a docent, so I get to see how people react. And, one of the tragedies is there's so many treasures and so few of them available to the public. And there's a couple of, you know, there's a collection of beautiful instruments at the Library of Congress, Stradivari, Armati, violins and cellos. And one of the wonderful provisions that was made by the donor is that they must be played. And so the great violinists and cellists from all over the world come to the Library of Congress to play these instruments. Now, see what that adds. Instead of the instrument just sitting in a glass shelf for forever, having people come in. I'm reading a wonderful book called The Hare with Amber Eyes about the Netsuke collection and the story of that collection of these little Japanese objects. And so as somebody said, the object in itself doesn't really mean a lot. It's the story that you can associate around that. And I grew up in Ireland, and the Book of Kells originally was put out on a glass case. And that was it. You looked at it, and I've seen the Book of Kells. Now they have a whole story. It's a whole presentation. And so what I'm hearing throughout this conference is very encouraging. People love rare books. They love rare objects, special things. And the more that can be made available to people, but with the story that goes with them. I mean, somebody mentioned, you know, just take the journey of ideas from the author's head to the reader's head, and all of the steps that happen in between, as one of the speakers alluded to. So I, you know, your comments sort of triggered these thoughts, and I love the direction that everybody seems to be trending, and the desire to make all of these treasures more widely available, but more widely interesting. You know, when people come to the Library of Congress, they see the Gutenberg Bible. Now, if they come by themselves, they go and they see it sitting in a glass case, and they look at it and say, oh, you know, big deal. You know, it holds their attention for 10 seconds. But when they hear the story about it, and the story, I can tell, is very limited, but it's the story about it, and everything it means and what it signifies, that is really the interesting thing. And Dan, you were alluding to that as well. So, but thank you, panel. Super presentations.
Thank you. Any other comment? Yes.
Hi, I'm Kate Dunning from Case Western Reserve University. I have a master's in library science, and I'm working on a PhD in English. And so something that came up earlier during Dan's talk really sort of stuck with me, and that was thinking about what the impact on research is as a result of digital texts, and how that sort of breaks down these walls and, you know, sort of opens up all of these different possibilities. And as somebody getting ready to go out on the job market and thinking about library jobs, academic jobs, you know, non-academic jobs, you know, the business world, it strikes me that the walls aren't necessarily coming down as much as we think they are. I mean, you know, anybody who reads the New York Times, you know, on their phone, you know, is that, you know, if you don't have a subscription after, you know, 10 articles this month, you have to switch to a different browser on your phone so you can keep reading.
Right.
I'm a graduate student. What can I say? I probably have 3 or 4 different browsers on my phone. But so what I'm thinking about, and also I spent 10 months in Cameroon on a Fulbright grant teaching, and I can't even tell you how many of my colleagues would come up to me and ask me if I could log into my databases here to help them get articles because they didn't have access to the articles. And so in some cases, you know, the digital resources are breaking down walls. I mean, the Emily Dickinson Archive through Harvard is amazing, absolutely amazing in terms of creating accessibility and really working towards these ideals of openness and access that we have. But at the same time, there are costs to producing these digital materials, you know, as we see in journalism examples, as we see with, you know, academic journals and databases. And so, you know, I think working with that balance and sort of trying to, you know, struggle through that tension between the ideals of openness and access and the fact that there are costs and investments of time and, you know, economic resources is something that I think is really a challenge and is something that definitely needs to be tackled as we're going forward. And so I would love to hear what your thoughts on that are, you know, what you see happening from your different perspectives and where you see that going.
I have to smile because I'm thinking about a generational difference in observation, because there's too much available in my mind, and for you there's not enough. So we're working, obviously we're working with access. Certainly if you go on any institutional library collection now, you can gain access to their catalogs. You can understand what's
yeah.
there.
Well, it's but, not enough, but it's also what constituencies have access. So, for mm-hmm. example, if I leave academia, if I leave the library and I go into right. business, for example, I won't be able to continue my research
right.
in the same way, because I won't have that access anymore.
Well, it's true, but you do have opportunities to become the friend of a library. You do have opportunity.
Yes, I'm actually a paying member of the Alumni Association.
Well, very
at my
good. That's a good start.
Master's Institute.
There's another obstacle, I think. you referred to the Harvard Emily Dickinson Archive. Mm-hmm. It's actually the Harvard Amherst
yes.
Archive. And,
yes,
and
yes. There are a lot of institutions
that
are.
I say that as an yes. Amherst person, but
yes.
But the point is.
And the Jones Library and Boston Public
that,
Library.
That archive is only recently up and available,
mm-hmm.
partly because the negotiations between Amherst and Harvard were contentious.
Mm-hmm.
An obstacle that is little recognized, but I think very much present, and I see this as a collector, is not only are collectors competitive with each other, but libraries are competitive. And they are possessive. And in the course of breaking down obstacles, one obstacle that has to be broken down, I think, is the wall that makes libraries, some libraries, not all, make some libraries want to build a wall around what they have and not share it. It's true that scholars don't, especially graduate students, and graduate students at institutions that can't afford to subscribe to every database, are at a disadvantage. I think those are the kind of problems that can be solved and that will be solved over time. So maybe too late to help you, but I think the day is coming.
If I can add, this is really a call for open access. I work at an institution that has deep relationships with Latin America and Africa, and scholars in those regions cannot get access to materials that are every day for our scholars. And so I hope that those of you who are part of institutions do your damnedest to put things online for free. Make it available how people need to use it, where they need to use it, and share global cultural heritage.
I'd like to chime in just for a second to add to that, which in my talk I talked about a writer who may have died and we don't know where his photographs or her photographs are because they're online somewhere in the mm-hmm. cloud. Another thought that occurred to me in that same context was that if a writer dies and we don't know that such accounts exist and they stop paying for them,
right.
they disappear. And all of the photographs, all of the records, all of the documents that person had, because this was a paying service mm-hmm. and not put somewhere free. There's an economic dimension to digital existence that we sometimes just assume or take for granted because we have access, you know, it's part of, we're in the institution or whatever, but it shouldn't be ignored that it's very, very different to have to sustain economic activity for these artifacts to continue to exist.
Yes, it's absolutely. It's a long-term commitment, and you have to have institutions, not just people.
Yeah, that's absolutely true.
I have another question.
Athena Jackson, University of Michigan, and thank you, panelists, for setting the bar for other panelists to go back and rewrite their talking points and make sure they're just as smart and pithy as what you are. My question is about all of you combined something beautiful together. You say the global cultural heritage, and I think also Alice said that in her talk as well. And then we talk about things like sort of the new audience that you mentioned. And we have the 2020 census coming up, where just in the United States, this audience is about to change and rock this country. And I'm very happy for that. I think it's time that we have a strong representation in our special collections that reflect the communities that are coming into our institutions. So I'm going to ask each of you, or one of you, or two of you, to just talk about the enduring elements of perhaps stepping outside of the context of Western European collection development and descriptive bibliography and all of these beautiful things that we all learn and subscribe to, and think about what would be enduring that we can take with us so that we can embrace this new audience and have that true significance of global cultural heritage. Thank you.
I can only tell you about an experience I had recently. I was at a board dinner, and there was a woman sitting next to me who was at the University of Virginia, and I think she's Korean, a Korean American, and she was a dean of one of the arts and sciences areas. I forget her name. And we were talking back and forth, and I'm at the Folger Shakespeare Library, so it's, you know, it's understood I know something about Shakespeare. I mean, it's not really true, but she was asking me, we were talking back and forth, and she said to me, "Do you know how Koreans learn English?" And it had never occurred to me. And she said to me that Koreans learn English by reading Shakespeare. She said, "Do you know how many Koreans understand English through the study of William Shakespeare?" And it just completely opened my mind to this opportunity for this new audience. But she actually took me to task as a representative of the Folger because, you know, we hadn't been dealing with issues like this. I mean, we have the Shakespeare editions, which are online, and they've been tagged, and we're doing a lot of work with that, but we're hoping to work with Simon & Schuster, our publisher, to put them into Spanish. So these are you know, decisions that are being mulled over by the administration. But it does go to your point that institutions are facing these issues. And for me, it was the first time I really had thought about it.
Well, you need people who reach out to other groups and who are willing to be uncomfortable in your institution.
Yeah.
And please. Don't load everything on the diversity person. It's everybody's job to be uncomfortable and to learn. And we're all about learning. Why aren't we trying harder to learn about things that are so very different and that enrich us?
I'm not sure how exactly this addresses the question you were asking, but a year or so ago, I sold a collection of Native American literature to Amherst College, and it was a collection that started from the 1770s and went up to very recent years. Their special collections now is preserving that. A collector put that together over about 25 years. The other way that I've seen the special collections libraries that I've dealt with address this has been I've sold a number of Native American writers' literary archives to a variety of institutions. And oftentimes, those writers are people who are trying to integrate their cultural traditions and tribal traditions and an oral tradition with the written word and with the Western European approach to things. And so that at least some special collections libraries already seem to be stepping up to try to recognize and preserve those things, the ones who bought those archives. And I'm really happy to be involved in that.
We just have time for two more questions. So,
I have two quick comments. First of all, I'm a museum infiltrator here, and I go to museum conferences, and I see the librarians roll their eyes at museums' newfound enthusiasm for structured information. And I go to library conferences, and I see museum people roll their eyes at libraries' newfound enthusiasm for exhibitions. And at a Harvard panel 3 years ago, the heads of the SAA, the ALA, and the AAM had never been together in a room. And I think that on the network level, we could really work together if we could get get in the room together. That's my first comment. The second comment is, like all Americans, I feel that I own a little bit of Shakespeare. And a couple of years ago, the Folger Shakespeare Library newsletter started coming into my email box. And I put it aside and I save it. And the remarkable thing that happened was the last time I was in Washington, when I walked into that institution, it was mine. So well done.
I'll pass that along.
Final question or comment.
My name is Tom Slavin. I'm with the Rofan Club here in Cleveland. To those of you who are here, welcome to Ohio. Happens to be the home of Dart Hunter. Dart Hunter was a famous paper maker. And I wanted to frame my comments and ask for your response in this way. Really, we're talking about allocation of resources. There are finite resources that each library has, each special collections department has, and there are lots of places to spend that money, for people, for books, or digitization. My concern is that lots of us get on the newest horse. There's a momentum that is associated with that new horse. And I think back at old Dart Hunter and his papermaking, and I wonder just how in the hell you're going to be able to determine anything through a digitized version of Dart Hunter's watermarks. Or how are you going to be able to measure byte in letterpress printing from turn of the century in England, for example. So my comment is, don't allocate all your resources toward digitization, buying these precious items that are difficult, in my opinion anyway, to understand without actually touching, feeling. You can't see byte in a digitized presentation. So the allocation of resources has to be made in such a fashion so that we preserve some bucks for acquisition of new materials. Otherwise, people like myself and my book interests are going to evaporate. I'd be interested if any of you have any comments. Thank you very much.
Any disagreement with?
We have an acquisition budget, which we allocate every year. Part of it is restricted funds, and the balance comes from allocated funds from the general endowment. And I think, I mean, my experience with institutions is that they're the most important buying power in the country. I think that they dwarf every other aspect of the purchasing books, maybe except the trade buying from one another. But there are collections all over the country, and there are significant amounts of money that are being spent, not only from the East Coast and sort of the big institutions, but in many historical societies. And so I think that I take your point, and if I was in your seat listening to what was being said, that there was such an emphasis on digitization. But believe me, there's a really powerful presence in the book market from the institutional market.
And that, if I could just add one thing to that. In some ways, institutions sometimes work against themselves, though. To take a recent example, it was a Boswell letter at auction a few months ago, and I was interested, as was Lauren Rothschild in California and Terry Seymour in New Jersey. We talked to each other and kind of decided what we thought the letter was worth and what we might bid on it, and we went to the auction and learned that Harvard was bidding on the letter. Now, Harvard has money from Mary Hyde Eccles to buy Johnson and Boswell materials. When I knew that Harvard was bidding, I dropped out. as to the other two, in a fit of pique, I think, they just kept acting as the underbidder and pushed the price up to what seemed to us as an absurd level. Sorry. But you bought it.
I'm just an administrator. Don't tell me.
But I guess my point is that if a library were really working with collectors, that wouldn't have happened, because ultimately a collector would have bought that letter, and probably that letter would have ultimately gone to the institution. So I'm not talking about bid rigging or price fixing, but I am talking about a level of cooperation that is rare. They'd look out for themselves. Somebody's here from Sotheby's, I think, or Kristen.
Yes, and I attempted to ask a question, but Joel said we were out of the market.
And we are out of time. Please join me in thanking the panel.